It's theCUBE, covering OpenStack Summit 2016. Brought to you by the OpenStack Foundation and headline sponsors, Red Hat and Cisco. Now here are your hosts, Stu Miniman and Brian Gracely.
And join with Brian Gracely, and we are live at the OpenStack Summit 2016 here in beautiful Austin, Texas. This is theCUBE's fourth year at the summit, to my personal third year at the event. Brian, we were trying to figure out how many of these you've been to.
Yeah, I think I've been to five, so yeah.
So it's interesting. We're going to have three full days of coverage here. They said when this first started, the first OpenStack Summit was here in Austin, and there were 75 people.
Right.
This year we've got 7,500 people here. When the camera's on Brian, you'll see the people streaming out from the keynotes here. A lot of people that we've seen in many years of these shows, but starting to see a lot of familiar faces to us, but new to OpenStack.
Right.
I said it's a lot of those people that were in the VMware ecosystem, kind of figuring out where this fits. In the Mirantis keynote this morning, Boris was saying it's kind of the DevOps ninjas versus the VMware sysadmins, and that migration and change. Lots of stuff to go in through, Brian. But what's your thoughts so far in the opening keynote in the event?
So my initial thought, and I'll sort of throw it back. Everybody's talking about prints these days. The thing that it dawns to me, because I was at the very second one, life is just a party, but parties weren't meant to last. We're now in that stage where it's sort of past the OpenStack hype. It's now into people having to do the real work. The last couple of years have really been about OpenStack being far less sexy, far less exciting, and a lot of real work getting done. We're seeing, about 3,000 contributors, about 350 companies, I think was the number of people that are contributing to OpenStack. We're seeing it get into telcos, into NFV, so moving away from, that sort of bifurcation they have of, do we compete against Amazon? Are we competing against VMware? To me, it's gotten to a point where it's sort of finding its niche in the marketplace. Jonathan Bryce talked about 50 of the top 100 Fortune 500 companies have OpenStack somewhere. But the big message that I heard as well was, OpenStack is part of the disruption. OpenStack is part of what companies are doing. It's that programmable infrastructure. And I think the OpenStack Foundation, the OpenStack community has figured out, we play a role. We don't have to take on everything. We have to let the cloud native things do what they do. We have to let the providers do what they do. So it's coming along, I think, very well.
Yeah, so there's always, in the analyst world, we love when there's the data. So there's a really good user survey that the OpenStack Foundation has done like every 6 months, and we're actually going to have a couple of sessions today that'll dig into it, so don't want to go to it too much. But right, as you said in the keynote, they said half of the Fortune 100 are using OpenStack. Of course, one of the things I'd look at and say, okay, that doesn't mean that all of their infrastructure is on it.
No.
And you look at who's in the Fortune 100, and it was like, keynote speakers like AT&T, great, they're building services with that. You look, SAP was up on stage. Well, right. These are technology providers, so the three big groups that they talked about were kind of the telcos, going to talk a lot about NFV, network function virtualization, when it comes to those folks. We've got, the technology suppliers, so there's the companies that are building clouds based on OpenStack.
So, right.
We'll have Rackspace on today, GoDaddy's one of the people here. Of course, you've got companies like IBM, Cisco, Hewlett Packard Enterprise, all building services. So they're users, but they're also the ones that are helping build it.
Right.
One of the things I've looked at the last couple of years is how many people stood up when they say, hey, who's contributed code to OpenStack? Because it was really, it was those devs and those code contributors that made up a lot of the summit. And over the last year or so, we're seeing more of the users. We're focusing a little bit more on some of the operations. And how do we get it into production? How do we reduce friction to get it? One of the keynotes talked about, it's still those people and processes things are still needs to mature. We still need to get there. A comment I made is, we look at immature environments and we say, great, the code itself might be good, but I've got to put some big professional services or send people out to do this. And if we look at like when public cloud is, I don't need to send 10 people. You can start small, you can start playing with the code, and you can mature with it, but it's more software-led than it is services-led. And today, there's a lot of services in the OpenStack environment.
Yeah, but that services has always been a dominant part of open source, right? Everybody wants to say, well, we're going to be the next Red Hat. Red Hat is fundamentally a services company. You look at some of the other big open source projects that are going, whether it's around big data and Hadoop, whether it's around Cloud Foundry, you know, the numbers that are coming out there are still very services centric. It's, you know, public cloud provides a great mechanism to get started, but even in the OpenStack, I mean, one of the big themes that's going on around OpenStack these days is how many more managed OpenStack services there are. Essentially, private cloud as a service. So, you know, you talk about what IBM and Blue Box does. You talk about Cisco and MetaCloud. I was sort of expecting, you know, Boris from Mirantis to go, hey, here's our new announcement. You know, we're going to, you know, sort of get in that space. We're going to talk to Rackspace. So, it's that evolution of like, hey, it is hard, but now there's options to sort of help you get part of the way there.
So, Brian, I totally agree. I mean, you think back to when IBM invested $1 billion in Linux. That helped drive a lot of IBM Global Services.
Yep.
The question I have for you is, if we look at, you know, Amazon, we look at Azure, it's the marginal economics are really about software. It's not about services. So, will public cloud put pressure on that? Can we have kind of that traditional services model? Or to be competitive against the public clouds, will it need to be a little bit more turnkey, a little bit more baked with less of a services component?
Yeah, I think that's sort of the easy narrative, but you look at, you know, Amazon had huge announcements with, Accenture had huge announcements with Amazon building an entire business unit. I was at the Google Cloud event. Tons of, you know, Tata was there, a number of big SIs saying, look, we're going to help you get there. The end of the day, you know, getting to these cloud models, you know, Boris was right, you know, 9 out of 10 problems people have with getting to cloud is people and process. You know, I actually think the people that are in that SI part of the industry are going to sort of take over becoming what the VARs were. They're going to take over that, you know, sort of rack and stack low-lying stuff, but people still struggle for how to get there. They still struggle for how do I change my business. But there were some cool examples. The SAP one had, you know, I want to talk about not making tires anymore for Goodyear, but mileage as a service. They're talking about air compressor companies doing sort of PSI and air as a service. You know, that's the mindset that's happening. You know, Under Armour doing fitness as a service as opposed to selling clothes. That's the mindset that sort of has to happen. IT has always been about, you know, reduced cost, highly available, and now everybody's talking digital and saying, how do I move my business? That's a long transition. So, you know, sometimes we want to blame OpenStack for not getting everybody there. They're a piece of this puzzle, and I think Jonathan Bryce sort of, you know, finally came to that conclusion this week.
Yeah, that's a great point, Brian. The term from last year was really being an integration engine. So, being a piece of the overall puzzle, you know, one of the things we've been trying to tease out, how does OpenStack fit with kind of the big public clouds? In the user survey, a lot of those people that answered, of course they're using AWS. I mean, you know, my joke's always, right, there's two types of users out there. There's the ones that are using AWS and those that haven't done a good survey of their environment, checked their IPs because, yeah, they're
right,
using AWS.
Right.
I talked to somebody from Microsoft that's here at OpenStack and they're like, oh, come on, just put a little wrapper on stuff. We can put stuff into Azure. We can work with OpenStack. You know, Google is stepping up their game. Happy we're going to have, you know, a representative from Google on theCUBE tomorrow. So, you know, lay out for us, you know, is it bimodal on clouds, or, you know, did these things all fit together?
Look, everybody talks about hybrid cloud, they talk about multi. We've been hybrid cloud and multi-cloud for a long time. I mean, people have been using SaaS applications, some are using AWS, some are, you know, beginning to use Azure and so forth. You know, the thing that's really interesting to me though is you look at some of those user surveys, and, you know, one of the number one, at least most commonly referenced reasons why they're thinking about this is, I want some interoperability. People are still believing, whether it's going to happen or not, that the clouds are going to kind of work out some at least low-level way that they're going to be kind of consistent. And whether that's an API, whether that means OpenStack's going to kind of go back and adopt some of the open APIs, whether we'll see an AWS, we saw Google starting to say, you know what, I got to get some of that enterprise money up here in my cloud, I'll extend those APIs for you. We're going to see those sort of things. They're not sexy, they don't make the best of headlines, but they're the kind of work that kind of has to get done if you want to help customers. And that's what it all kind of comes down to. We're still in the really early innings. You know, Boris made a great point. Granted, he was, you know, using it as a marketing hype, but Amazon's a $10 billion company, they're growing really fast. And then you say it's a $2 trillion industry, it's still a small number. You know, what Amazon does versus what Google does in a month versus what Microsoft does in a month is still relative, and you got to kind of keep that in perspective sometimes.
Yeah, it was interesting. There was a tweet from Martin Casado, and I was just looking up. He said, as functionality moves up the stack from hardware, you know, through the hypervisor operating system middleware, does the market actually get smaller? So one of the things, there was an analyst that said, AWS may only be $10 billion, but that displaced $30 billion worth of others. So, it's having, more of an impact proportional to what they had. It's like the old guerrilla warfare is they're taking out a lot of traditional stuff by non-traditional means. So from that angle, Brian, I mean, what's your take on kind of the developer community here? We talk some of the private cloud discussion is always, does it really talk to your developers, or are you just selling to your old storage and networking teams?
Right.
What's your take on how the developer angle fits here?
I think the developer piece at the most simple level is developers want programmable something, right? And in this case, it's infrastructure. I think the great myth of all these things talking about DevOps is, that the order of it is DevOps. It really should be sort of ops, dev, because the folks here are primarily operations people. They're primarily trying to serve that developer community, let them go faster. I think at some point OpenStack sort of had these ambitions that they were going to have, native OpenStack applications. They were going to be essentially a PaaS layer. That didn't really happen, and that's fine. There's really nothing wrong with that. But this is really about saying, like, look, if you are going to be in the operations business, you're going to be in the ops side of things, which can help reduce costs, can help differentiate your business, be really good at it. Figure out how to be better at doing this. What we saw from, say, AT&T today was all about ops. I mean, it was talking about developers building new tools to make ops more effective, help them get to 1,000 availability zones. It's really, to your point about do things go away, it really becomes, can I actually get from the traditional vendors building very horizontal boxes the stuff I want, or do I have to have the ability to build it myself? We're starting to see that a little bit, and that's where that displacement starts to happen.
Yeah, to some great points there. One of them, we look at where VMware is. So
isn't,
because first of all, I'm talking to a couple of the VMware folks that are here, and I said, well, from day one, the NYSERA folks were here. They were heavily involved. So from the networking angle, VMware has had a lot of play. But for the kind of full stack piece,
right.
VMware's there. In the user survey, it was 9% of customers that responded, were using vSphere.
Right.
But you kind of wonder about the data because we know lots of those big enterprises are using VMware.
Yep.
And so is it that OpenStack's in a sandbox, and that sandbox I don't want to pay for licensing, and
right.
when I go to production, maybe I'll do it. Even some of the big telcos are using VMware, so it's not a binary OpenStack
right.
comes in, VMware goes away. VMware's still got a strong presence in the data centers, and OpenStack today is really an on-premises discussion.
Yep.
So what's your take? Do people still kind of mess that up as to where VMware fits? Or
I think there's a bunch of things, and this is actually a really this year, this summit, what's going on with the Dell EMC VMware merger is sort of interesting, because if you just play it out by technology, you could lay it out and say, well, VMware's going to be sort of relegated to, you want to call it mode one applications, legacy applications, things that need tons of availability at the infrastructure level. But we saw today, one of the underlying themes today, and we're going to hear about it all week, is like, how do I start to run some of those legacy applications in Oracle and Microsoft and SAP on OpenStack? Does that make any sense? Is that something I want to do? Obviously, I would guess most of the OpenStack vendors here would love to start seeing that happen because it's a bigger piece of the pie. And VMware's got to figure out where they want to be in this. One of the really interesting data points of the user survey, without giving it all away, is the number one reason people were looking at OpenStack, the most dominant one, was I want it to be cheaper, right? We've heard it over and over again. I want free VMware. I want cheaper VMware. That thing is going to keep pushing. That drumbeat's going to keep pushing. People are going to figure out, where VMware shakes out of this merger. It's an interesting time between the two. I think you're going to hear Red Hat pushing very hard on it. You're going to hear Mirantis. But more importantly, you're seeing these hosted offerings. I keep coming back to it. But those are the people that are going to sort of be displaced to run that thing, and those are VMware displaced people, and that's why you see so many people here that we used to see at VMworld are saying, hey, do I need to go learn OpenStack? And I think we'll continue to see that.
Yeah, so Brian, you've been digging in on your research about kind of that discussion of applications.
Yep.
You know, what goes where, how does it fit? As we said, it's not a simple discussion. No. It is very nuanced. There's certain things you can say, well, you know, if it has this, and this type of characteristics, you know, right, if I need it up for, you know, hours, days or something, I'm probably not going to spend 9 months building an infrastructure for it. And then at the other end, if it never changes and it, you know, very cost sensitive, it probably isn't going to go on certain classes of public cloud.
Right.
Can you fill us in a little bit about what you're working on the research? Just kind of, if it's OpenStack related, great, but just in general, give us a flavor as to what people that would read your research on Wikibon would find.
Yeah, so really been focused on two or three really big areas. Like you said, one is sort of application rationalization, application portfolio. Where should I put stuff? And that's probably the biggest question. Should I move stuff to the cloud? When do I move to the cloud? So we've been trying to, in as simple a way as possible, is saying, like, look, here's the characteristics of things that make sense in a, you know, on-demand metered public cloud. Here's the places where, you know, you can augment your IT organization. So that's one of the areas. The other big one is really looking at these sort of digital business platforms, digital businesses. Everybody nowadays is talking about it. You know, they want to talk about, I think Gartner said, like, look, those 20% of those applications today are going to end up driving 40% of your business. Really trying to help people understand what's different about that. What does that mean? So we've got about a 5 or 6 piece set of research that's out this week and last week and next week. Helping people understand, like, okay, what are the core pieces? Where do I focus on it? OpenStack plays a role in that, but you know, throughout the year, as we're at DockerCon, as we're at Cloud Foundry Summit, they're going to play a role in this as well. So those are the two big things, because again, they come back to, do I move to cloud? How fast do I move to cloud? And what should I put in the cloud? And then the associated people and process.
All right. So that's great, Brian. One of the other things that was discussed in the keynote was, you know, Gartner got up.
Yep.
They talked a little bit about bimodal. And that caused, I love Jonathan Bryce got up and he said, some people love it and some people hate it. And then his follow-up actually said, that's what he's seeing from a lot of enterprises. So, every analyst firm that's not Gartner, we've all had our take on it. You know, David Floyer, our CTO, wrote his piece on it. I know when I talk on the infrastructure side, it's very rare that we can say, hey, just, you know, stick one thing in a sandbox and stick one thing over here. That integration effort, you want to have platforms, you want to be able to move things back and forth, you need to understand the skill sets. It's not, you know, pets over here, cattle's over here, and you know, shoot one thing.
Right.
I made a joke. I said it's IT is Schrodinger's cat. It's either dead or alive. It's like, come on, give me a little break. There was some phenomenal snark on Twitter, regarding it. What's your take on this?
So, you know, I think a couple of things. Number one, one of the things that you learn when you've been in this industry for a long time is the subconscious of the community's soul or the company's soul comes out in their keynote. No matter what they want to say, what they're thinking comes out in there. And I think at the end of the day, it says, look, the OpenStack Foundation wants to get, you know, acceptance by the enterprise. And they know that the enterprise trusts Gartner. Whether or not you buy into bimodal or not, I'm not a big fan of it. I don't think it works the way it should. But the other thing, I think what's always very interesting is Gartner tends to put up a bimodal thing, and then you get experience from people that are actual doers, and you very rarely say, boy, these two match. And I think that's what people are really saying is, you know, are you trying to convey that we're enterprise ready by using somebody like Gartner, or should we be telling our story through the super user groups and those types of things? To me, I think we're still seeing, you know, if you put it in Gartner lingo, most of the focus of OpenStack is in mode 2. I think that's where they should be. That's where they're going to differentiate the business. But it was a very interesting placement right at the beginning. We're going to try and establish right at the beginning. We love the enterprise, and you can trust us.
Yeah. So last year Gartner had actually said that OpenStack was a science project, and we tore into it on theCUBE, and we were saying, look, you know, this isn't a science experiment. It's something that's maturing. You know, show me a good technology that's going to be a foundational layer, and say, oh, in 5 years it's gone from ideation to the platform that everybody runs things on. We know this takes maturity.
Right.
You know. We, compute got solid, storage got solid, networking finally got solid.
It's getting better, yeah.
The rest of the stack, the core pieces, what's certified, they're getting out training. OpenStack, is maturing the way that, if you think about it rationally, it should. It's good to see Gartner, getting on board and supporting the community. So, Brian, we've got 3 days of coverage here. What kind of key big things are you looking for this week?
Well, anytime you come to OpenStack Summit, it's always about users. Everybody's looking for validation from users, and to a certain extent, they're trying to figure out the dynamic, because most of the conferences that people attend are very vendor-dominated. They're very, one theme dominated. This is a community event, but people are still trying to flesh out, well, let's translate community contributions to who's the winners and losers. Those are always the thing we're trying to flesh out, and then we're trying to figure out at the technology level, what's happening? What are the Red Hats of the world, the Ciscos of the world, the Intels of the world doing to make this technology easier? So we're going to flesh a lot of that out, excited about that.
Yeah, that's great stuff. So yeah, we are going to have a number of users on the program here. Really want to have a big shout out to our sponsors. Without our sponsors, we could not bring this programming here. SiliconANGLE Media, really excited to be here for the fourth year. The first year when John Furrier and Jeff Frank went to Portland, a number of people actually said, wow, we think OpenStack, maybe it's really for real because theCUBE's here. So love this community, and big shout out to the sponsors. So first of all, anchor sponsors, it's Red Hat in partnership with Cisco. An additional sponsorship from EMC, NetApp with SolidFire, that's now a NetApp, part of NetApp through the acquisition, and EMC. So 3 days, wall-to-wall coverage. I'm Stu Miniman here with Brian Gracely. Hit us up on the Twitters if you're at the Convention Center, prime location here in the level one, the main hallway, kind of halfway between registration and the keynotes. So lots of coverage here, the users, the thought leaders, people building the code, people putting these things in production. Thanks very much for watching. We'll be here with lots more coverage after this quick break.